Anyway, open your Bibles to John, the Gospel of John. I know Pastor Chris mentioned a couple weeks back that I was going to be doing John chapter 2. And so that's where we're going to be this morning, John chapter 2. But what I'm going to do first is Pastor Chris left off, I think right around verse 43 of chapter 1. So I'm just going to read through those remaining verses, and I'm going to give you an extra credit assignment, okay? So it says in John 1:43, the following day Jesus went to go to Galilee, and he found Philip and said to him, "Follow me." Now Philip was from Bethsaida, the city of Andrew and Peter. Philip found Nathanael and said to him, "We have found him of whom Moses in the law and also the prophets wrote, Jesus of Nazareth, the son of Joseph." And Nathanael said to him, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" And Philip said to him, "Come and see." And Jesus saw Nathanael coming towards him and said of him, "Behold, an Israelite indeed in whom is no deceit." Nathanael said to him, "How do you know me?" And Jesus answered and said to him, "Before Philip called you, when you were under the fig tree, I saw you." Nathanael answered and said to him, "Rabbi, you are the Son of God. You are the King of Israel." Jesus answered and said to him, "Because I said to you, I saw you under the fig tree, do you believe? You will see greater things than these." And he said to him, "Most assuredly, I say to you, hereafter you shall see heaven open and the angels of God ascending and descending upon the Son of Man." Now, for your extra credit assignment, I want you to write this down. Genesis chapter 28, verses 10 through 17. Genesis 28, verses 10 through 17. Now, I'm not going to give you any hints, okay? So if you go do your homework assignment and you've tied Genesis 28, verses 10 through 17 into that little passage we just read, I want you to send me a message on social media. Text me if you have my number, okay? I want to know that you did the homework assignment, and I'll give you an attaboy, and then you'll feel good about yourself. No, you might learn something, okay? Just remember this. The Bible interprets the Bible for us, okay? So when you go back to Genesis and you read that, it's going to interpret a portion of what we just read there. Okay, again, no more hints than that. That's it, okay? All right, so we're going to move on into John chapter 2. This is kind of a fun chapter. And so John chapter 2, verse 1, it says, "On the third day, there was a wedding in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. Now both Jesus and his disciples were invited to the wedding. And when they ran out of wine, the mother of Jesus said to him, 'They have no wine.' And Jesus said to her, 'Woman, what does your concern have to do with me? My hour has not yet come.' And his mother said to the servants, 'Whatever he says to you, do it.'" And Father, we just ask this morning that you would give us understanding and insight into your word, that you would teach us by your spirit. We want to hear you loud and clear this morning in Jesus' name. Amen. And so Jesus goes to this wedding, right? I kind of did like an outline form for my notes. My notes vary from Bible study to Bible study. Sometimes I only do notes in my Bible. Sometimes I do paper notes. Sometimes I do an outline. Sometimes I just write some things that I want to remember down. So verses 1 through 5, I titled this, "The Wedding and the Wine Problem." And it says, in a Jewish wedding, right, that's what they would be going to here in Cana of Galilee. A Jewish wedding is much different from the weddings that we would go to today. You get a wedding invitation in the mail, you RSVP, you show up. Typically, you go to a ceremony. If you're lucky, it's not on a hot, sunny day outside. And you get your head sunburned, okay? But I went to a Catholic wedding one time, and not only was it the longest ceremony I've ever been to, it was the hottest day in August that I think ever existed, and I got fried. I looked like a lobster when we were done. But anyway, so these weddings, we typically go that. Then following a wedding, you'll go to a reception. There's, you know, usually dinner and dancing and all fun is had. The bride and groom take off and everybody else goes home, and that's the end of it. It's a one-day event. Jewish weddings were not like that. Typically, it was a seven-day event. And we don't have a lot of time to go into all of the details of the Jewish wedding, but again, another extra credit assignment. Go study what a Jewish wedding festival looks like. It's a beautiful picture of our relationship with the Lord and what we have in store for us. Okay, but to make a long story short, they would have this period of time called a betrothal, which is about a one-year process. During that time, the husband and wife were not, I mean, they were legally married. They shared everything together, but they did not live together. It was a binding agreement. So if they were to break a betrothal, there had to be a divorce that would happen, a legal divorce that would have to happen. During the betrothal time, the bridegroom would go away to his father's house, and he would build onto his father's house a room for him and his bride to then live in, okay? And then he could come, once that room was built, it was up to his father to say, that room that you just built is now ready. Go get your bride. And then he would go, and it would be at, could be at any time. The bride didn't know. The bridesmaids didn't know. They had to be ready at any time for the bridegroom to show up. Because he would come and he would show up, and the seven-day wedding feast would begin to take place. There would be family and friends, and the neighborhood would be there, and they would be, whoever was invited to this wedding feast, and there would be dancing. And if you guys ever seen a Jewish festival or feast or a party of some sort, man, it is exciting to watch a Jewish festival, the music and the dancing and the food and the, I mean, it's a really exciting thing to watch. So you know this is a good time. It's a time of joy. It's a time of fellowship of families, a uniting of two families together. And then ultimately, the bride and the groom would consummate the marriage, and then they would go on with their lives from there. But it was a big event, a big festivities. And what you have to remember is that this is not Western culture. Here in our Western culture, if we have a wedding, and I know I'm in church, I probably shouldn't say this, but maybe you have an open bar, right, at your wedding. Typically, you're going to pay for the open bar for maybe an hour. And then after that, everybody's got to pay for their own drinks, okay? At a Jewish wedding, all of the drinks, the food, everything was the responsibility of the host. Eastern culture is a hospitable culture. It's a hospitality culture. Having traveled to Asia, having traveled to Russia, those places are very hospitality oriented. I can show up at somebody's house. They may be as poor as can be, but because you show up there and because we're both Christians, they're opening their door and they're giving me the best of whatever they have because they feel like it's their responsibility to take care of me. That's Eastern culture. Western culture is more like, yeah, come on over anytime. You're welcome anytime. And then you show up and they're like, well, I didn't really mean it. You actually showed up? Like, you didn't call. You didn't give me some notice. But that's Western culture. Eastern culture is very hospitable. I personally love Eastern culture. It's so warm and it's so inviting, and you really feel like family with people almost immediately. That's the picture of Scripture. As you read through everything in Scripture, look at it through the lens of that Eastern culture and hospitality. It gives you a different understanding of what's taking place in some of these instances. If we try to run everything through Western culture, it doesn't always work out. It makes us scratch our head and go, what are they doing? What are they talking about? Okay? So, for them to run out of wine at a wedding, there would be social repercussions. They would be looked at bad within their society. They invited us to this wedding, and they couldn't even provide for us through this seven-day feast. And so it says here that both Jesus and his disciples were invited to this wedding. And it doesn't really tell us, but it infers that they went to the wedding. They weren't just invited, but they went. And can I just tell you that Jesus loves weddings? You realize that as we're sitting here today, that God is the one who ordained marriage? I want you to flip with me or just listen. But back in Genesis chapter 1, in verse 27, it says, "So God created man in his own image. In the image of God, he created him, male and female, he created them." And that would be genetic, male and female. Natural, male and female. You get what I'm saying? There's no confusion with God. And there should be no confusion with what God's word says. It's pretty clear. And then if we look over at chapter 2, verse 21, remember Adam's been given dominion over the animals, and he's naming them, and he's seeing them come in pairs, male and female. And then Adam realizes, hey, there's no helper. There's no one for me. And it's really God who recognizes that Adam needs a helper. And men, can we say amen that we need a helper? I know I do. And the Lord God, it says in verse 21, caused a deep sleep to fall on Adam, and he slept, and he took one of his ribs and closed up the flesh in its place. Then the rib which the Lord God had taken from man, he made into a woman, and he brought her to man, brought her to the man. And Adam said, "This is now bone of my bone and flesh of my flesh, and she shall be called woman because she was taken out of man." Therefore, here it is, the institution of marriage. "A man shall leave his father and mother and be joined to his wife, and they shall become one flesh." God instituted marriage. Jesus loves weddings. And I have a question. This could be whether you're in an engagement period, whether you're married for 10 years, you're a newlywed. Have you invited Jesus into your marriage? Because it makes a huge difference. If you're trying to go at it in your marriage without Jesus, and you're just trying to figure all these problems of life out, it's going to be a lot of headbutting. It's going to be a lot of problems. But if you invite Jesus into your wedding, into your marriage, you can invite him to your wedding too, but into your marriage, it makes all the difference in the world. Having done marriage counseling a number of times, there's been couples that we've dealt with that they don't want Jesus in their marriage. And they can't figure it out. And they just butt heads. And you sit them down for counseling and you ask them where they're at in their walk with the Lord. And they, "I don't want to talk about that, she this and he that." And it's all this. Invite Jesus into your wedding. Or, there you go again. Into your marriage. And let him direct it. Run everything in your marriage through the filter of God's word and what it says. Check out the book of Ephesians. It gives instructions for husbands and wives and children and God's whole family structure. When we get out of order, out of God's order, things get messed up. But when we put them in God's order, everything doesn't run necessarily smoothly because we're still flawed human beings, but things go so much better. And if Jesus is at the center of that marriage, just like he should be at the center of everything that we do as Christians, we can't put Jesus in a box when we go to work. We can't put Jesus in a box when we go play sports or when we play video games or when we do whatever. Jesus should be at the center of everything that we do. And I'm exhorting myself with this too. Okay? And so Jesus is invited to the wedding. He shows up with his disciples. If you've been keeping count, how many disciples are there at this point? Four. Yeah, we've got Andrew and Peter and Philip and Nathanael are the ones who have been named up to this point, right? Interestingly enough, Nathanael, he is from this town of Cana. We learned that in John chapter 21. And so maybe perhaps that's the link to this wedding, that the disciples got invited because Nathanael is from Cana, so they invite them all. I'm not sure. But then it says in verse 3, Mary comes to Jesus with the problem, right? It's always good to come to Jesus with the problem. She said, "They've run out of wine." And so she tells Jesus, "They have no wine." And his response is kind of peculiar, right? Jesus said to her, "Woman, what does your concern have to do with me? my hour has not yet come. Now, when we hear this in our culture and Jesus says, woman, all the guys are like, yeah. But I picture this like, you know, I moved here from Texas, so I picture the belt buckle, woman, get my dinner. Right? That's kind of what we picture in our culture. It's not like that at all, okay? This is a different understanding. This is a respectful tone. I've heard it described as, which is kind of an antiquated term, but you could say like mother dearest, right? We don't talk like that too much anymore. But let me give you an example from a mission trip that I went on, okay? This will help you understand, I think. So we went to Russia, and in Russian, the word for grandmother is babushka, okay? So Americans, we're there with some of our Russian friends. And I don't know why we were talking about babushka, but one of the pastor's wife, her name's Alonia, we're saying babushka, and she goes, no, no, no. No babushka. American, harsh, right? She says, no babushka, babushka. With love. That's what she says, right? So you see the difference in the tone. She heard us saying babushka, and it's like, oh, this is harsh, babushka. But it should be babushka, with love, right? So you picture Jesus, not woman, woman, with love, right? And so he says, what does your concern have to do with yet come? Well, what hour is he talking about? He's talking about the hour, literally, of his death. Right? That's the hour that he's talking about. The hour began on when he rode his donkey into Jerusalem on Palm Sunday. And they begin to say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. That was the first time in Jesus' public ministry that he received worship, and he was ready to be proclaimed as king. Before that, he kept saying, he says it a number of times throughout the gospel, my hour is not yet come, my hour is not yet come. We can look here in John's gospel, four times the reference is made that the hour is not yet come. Number one here in John chapter 7, verse 6. It says, then Jesus said to them, my time has not yet come. And then he says in chapter 7, verse 30, therefore they sought to take him, but no one laid a hand on him because his hour had not yet come. Chapter 8, verse 20, it says, these words Jesus spoke in the treasury as he taught in the temple, and no one laid hands on him, for his hour had not yet come. Now, there's a shift. John chapter 12, verse 23, says, Jesus answered them, saying, the hour has come that the Son of Man should be glorified. That was on the same day as the triumphal entry. Chapter 13, verse 1, now before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour had come. And then chapter 17 of John, verse 1 says, Jesus spoke these words, lifted his eyes to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that your Son also may glorify you. So there was a shift. He said over and over, my hour has not yet come. My hour has not yet come. Then he shifts in his ministry and says, the hour has come. There was a specific time. Interestingly enough, if you think about your life and your walk and your relationship with the Lord, timing is everything. We can have an understanding from God that he's called us to do something, but timing is key. And seeking the Lord on that timing is a key to figuring stuff out. Otherwise, you may end up like, what's going on? Did I screw it up? Or you go out in the flesh and you mess things up trying to do it because you heard something. Think about Moses, right? We're told, that you remember when Moses killed the Egyptian? Why? Because Hebrews tells us that he believed that he was the one who was going to lead the people. And he was. He heard from God. He heard correctly, But the timing wasn't right. It wasn't until 40 years later that God said, hey, Moses, I want you to go back there and I want you to lead my people out of Egypt. He's like, oh, I can't do that now, Lord. The timing was everything. And so we can hear from the Lord, but when you hear from the Lord, that doesn't always mean jump out right away and go do everything. Seek the Lord for his timing, okay? Jesus said, my time has not yet come. But now, what does Mary do? Like every good mother, she ignores her son and she says, whatever he says to you, do it. And she says to the servants. Interestingly enough, do you realize these are the last recorded words of Mary in the scripture? Interesting, right? What's the last thing that Mary says? Do what he says. Do whatever Jesus tells you. Okay? And so, why was Mary in such a rush to get Jesus into the limelight? Why do you think she was in such a rush? Or it seems like she was in a rush. She's been the object of stigma for the last 30 years. Imagine, as a teenage girl, I got pregnant by the Holy Spirit. Sure you did. Right? Later on, Jesus, the religious leaders say, we weren't born of fornication. They're accusing Mary of being in an adulterous relationship. Mary's been living with this. She knows. Luke chapter 1, the angel told her, do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God, and behold, you will conceive in your womb and bring forth a son, and shall call his name Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Highest, and the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end. Mary's been waiting for 30 years to, like, okay, son, come on, do something. So, you can imagine trying to live with that. She knew what the angel told her, but nobody else. I mean, that's hard to believe. If you put yourself in her shoes, or even in the shoes of the other people of that day and age, that'd be a hard thing to swallow. I mean, where's Josh? Josh, kid in your youth group comes and says, yeah, I'm pregnant by the Holy Spirit. You're going to be like, maybe we should talk to your parents. Right? I mean, this would be hard to believe. And so Mary's last recorded words, do whatever he says to you. Mary was blessed among women, but Mary should not be worshipped. Mary is not a co-redemptress. Mary was not sinless. In her Magnificat, she cried out to God, my Savior. If she needed a Savior, she wasn't sinless. She didn't die for your sins, and she is not an intermediary between you and God. The Bible teaches that Jesus alone is the intermediary between God and men. When you get saved, Jesus takes up residence in your life through the person of the Holy Spirit, and we can now go right before the Lord. We can go right to the throne room of heaven. We can speak to God. We don't need a priest. You don't need a pastor. You don't need Mary. You don't need a saint. You don't need anybody. It just can go straight to the Lord yourself. And what's so cool, sometimes when we go to pray, we don't know what we're supposed to pray, but the Bible promises that the Holy Spirit takes those grunts and groans that we make not knowing what to say, and he perfects them right before the throne. So, verse 6, it says, now there were set 6 water pots of stone, according to the manner of purification of the Jews, containing 20 or 30 gallons apiece. And Jesus said to them, fill the water pots with water, and they filled them up to the brim. And he said to them, draw some out now and take it to the master of the feast. And they took it. And when the master of the feast had tasted the water that was made wine and did not know where it came from, but the servants who had drawn the water knew, the master of the feast called the bridegroom, and he said to him, every man at the beginning sets out good wine, and when the guests have well drunk, then the inferior. You have kept the good wine until now. So this is verse 11 says, this is the beginning of signs that Jesus did. This is the first recorded miracle of Jesus' ministry. Did Jesus do miracles before this? I don't know. The apocryphal books say that he did. You know, he fixed birds' wings and did some other stuff, but we don't really know. We know he was sinless for his entire life, but we don't know if he did any miracles before. This is the first recorded miracle of Jesus' ministry, was turning this water into wine. And so, but what I want to point out is that this miracle was not done in the public eye. This was sort of a behind-the-scenes miracle. And I would say that in our own lives, I believe this is where we see most miracles happen. We can often be like, sort of like the religious leader, show us a sign, or we want to see that leper be healed instantly, or we want to see that lame man get up and start walking. And, you know, those are the things we consider miracles. But how many of you have had an answered prayer in your life? Raise of hands. Now, that's a lot of hands go up. Guess what? You prayed, God answered. That was a miracle. We see those things. Jesus said that when we go into our quiet place and we pray, that what we pray in secret, the Father will reward openly. So you can know every time you go into the quiet place and you're praying about something quietly, maybe it's a wayward kid, or maybe it's a loved one who's not saved, or maybe it is for your marriage. You're bringing Jesus into your marriage because it's all messed up and you're like, I need some help here. And when you see those prayers answered, guess what you've just seen? You've seen miracles, okay? But they're not always in the public eye for everyone to see. But what's so cool is when Jesus does enter a marriage in particular, or like say a kid who's backslidden, and you're praying for them, and then they come back, and then God restores them, or God restores your marriage. It was something that happened in secret, but all of a sudden everybody else begins to see, because the fruit of that is bearing out in our lives. And so Jesus tells these servants, he says to fill the water pots. And what did they do? They filled them up, what? To the brim. They didn't have to. I love their obedience. They filled them up to the brim. And these aren't some small water pots. It says they're 20 to 30 gallons apiece. That's anywhere from 120 to 180 gallons of water. And it wasn't like they could just go to the faucet and turn it on. They had to either go to a well or go down to the water hole and like manually fill these things up. And then they had to carry them back. This is a lot of work. But they did what Jesus said. And then he tells them, again, he says, fill the water pots. They fill them up to the brim. Verse 8, it says, he said to them, now draw some of this water out and take it to the master of the feast. And they're probably going, wait a minute, hold on. They want wine, not water. Because when they filled up their ladle or their cup or whatever they filled up to take to the master of the feast, it was still water. At what point it changed from water to wine, I don't know. But imagine you're the servant and you're like going to the master and you're like, we're carrying water up here. I really hope this guy comes through. But then it says, when the master of the feast tasted it, was it still water in the ladle, and then when he tasted it, it miraculously changed to wine? Did it change halfway along the route? We don't know. But they did what Jesus said, regardless of what was in the jar. It was water. They needed wine. Jesus said, do it, and they did it. What God tells us to do doesn't always make sense. As a matter of fact, most of the time it doesn't make any sense. When you go into town, you'll find a donkey tied to the post. Just take the donkey. Bring it back to me. Oh yeah, and if anyone says anything, just tell them the Lord has need of it. Wait, you want us to do Grand Theft Donkey? I'm gonna go over there, I'm gonna grab this donkey. I mean, can you imagine when the disciples did that? Then they got the donkey and they're walking away, and they probably thought, okay, we got away with it. And then all of a sudden, someone goes, hey, what are you doing with that donkey? Boldly. The Lord has need of it. Or was it like, the Lord has need of it? Whatever happened, they did what Jesus said, and it worked out like he said. And we'll find that true in our lives too. It doesn't always make sense what God tells us to do as he instructs us, but when we do it, we find it just as the Lord said. And so here, these guys are instructed to take this water to the master of the feast who is in need of wine. Somewhere along the way, the water turns into wine. And it says in verse number 9 that the water was made wine, and they didn't know where it came from. But then the parentheses say, but the servants who had drawn the water knew. And I would just point out to you that they knew what had been done. The servants who took a step of faith knew what had been done. When God calls us to do something, it is a step of faith, and it is always one step at a time. I haven't met anyone yet who's ever walked in faith who saw the whole path laid out before them. Okay, I don't mean to bring up space trash for your mind, but anybody ever seen the old music video Billie Jean by Michael Jackson? Okay, so if you remember that video, they're walking on this path, and they take a step on the path, and one step lights up. And then they take another step, and it lights up, and then so forth, right? And I feel like that's sort of like how our walk of faith goes. The book of Ephesians tells us that these steps have been laid out before us so that we should just walk in them. The problem is we don't see them until we step out. It lights up. Now where, Lord? I can't see the next step. Just keep going. It lights up. And we see God meet us every time. Now, if I stepped out too far, I'd fall off the edge of the stage. But I can promise you this, if you're walking in faith and you're stepping out in faith, God is not going to let you fall off the edge of the stage. If you step out in faith and maybe you had it all wrong, but in faith you were sort of going the wrong direction, my God's big enough to pick me up and put me in the right direction. Okay, and still honor the step of faith that I took. Are we willing servants? These guys were willing. They filled the pot up to the brim. They took it, water, not even being wine, to the master of the house. They drank from it. It was wine. It says nobody knew, but the servants are like, whoa, we saw what happened. And that's what happens in our own lives. People don't know, right? You step out in faith, you do something according to God's will in your own life as you've been praying and seeking him. And sometimes people go, why would you do that? Right? My pastor back in Houston, he was a Major League Baseball player. He left the Major League Baseball to go pastor a church that wasn't doing very well. People said, you're nuts, dude. Why did you do that? God called me to do it. Well, the church is doing fine now. But it was each step of faith. Right? And so these guys saw it. You want to see God move in your life, take steps of faith. When you feel he's prompting you to do something, take a step of faith. When you read something in the Word, love your wife as Christ loved the church. Love your enemies. Forgive. Take a step of faith and do those things, and you'll see God work. Everybody else might not understand, but you'll know why. Servants of the Lord see God work. They see miracles. And so notice this also, Jesus, he gave them the best wine, the better wine, at the end, not at the beginning. Typically, what they would do is they'd give out the best wine that was like, you know, top shelf stuff at the beginning. And then when after everybody's gotten a little bit tipsy, then they start giving out the cheap stuff, right, the box wine, okay? And then, because nobody knows the difference, you sort of lose your palate. That's, you know, when you go to a restaurant and you have like a palate cleanser because you get sort of numb to the food that you're eating. Jesus, at the end, they're surprised because this is the best wine. Now, this isn't top stuff shelf at the beginning and the bad at the end. This is the top shelf at the end. Now we're getting the good stuff. They're blown away by this. And I would just point out that Jesus always leaves things better. He always leaves things better. Doesn't matter if it's a life, if it's a ministry, if it's a job, Jesus leaves it better. So, we have to talk about this whole wine thing, okay? Some people will say, well, it wasn't really wine, it wasn't fermented like it is today. It was wine. It was fermented. Some people will say, Jesus made water into wine so I can drink. And they justify their drinking because Jesus turned water into wine. If that's what you're doing, that's bad understanding of Scripture. Wine is supposed to be a sign of joy in the Scriptures. It's supposed to be, it can also be symbolic of the Holy Spirit who brings joy to our lives. However, I feel like that I would be doing a disservice to you if I didn't give you a warning as well. Okay, I don't want to talk to you legalistically, but I want to talk to you realistically. Okay, the Bible does not give any prohibition against drinking alcohol. Okay, the only prohibition that's given in Scripture is against drunkenness. The Bible says very clearly, do not be drunk with wine, but be filled to excess with the Holy Spirit. Okay? But I want to talk to you as a pastor, as a former police officer. I've never had one person tell me that their life was so much better because of alcohol. Okay? You realize that when you drink alcohol, judgment is one of the first things to go. Not like scriptural judgment, but your own cognitive judgment is one of the first things to go. That's why people make the decision, I'm okay, I can drive, I'm fine. Or they make rationalizations like this, I'm not as drunk as they are, so I'll be the one to drive. Okay? It's why affairs happen when there's been alcohol involved. It's why domestic violence happens when there's been alcohol involved. Okay, the Bible gives strong warning with alcohol. Proverbs is full of warnings. Like we mentioned already, drunkenness is forbidden. Do you realize that the first two mentions of alcohol in the Bible are in a negative context? Noah was the first mention of alcohol in the Bible. Noah got drunk after planting a vineyard, and something happened with his son that was a shameful thing, and Noah then ended up having to curse his grandchild as a result of that. The next mention of alcohol in the Bible is with Lot, Abraham's nephew. Lot goes, and his daughters get him drunk, then they have an incestuous relationship, and you get these two nations, Moab and Ammon, who come from that, and they become a perpetual thorn in the side of God's people, Israel. And so, I'm going to tell you personally the reasons why I have chosen not to drink anymore. One, being in ministry, being a pastor, I can't do very well to go minister to someone who's struggling with alcohol if I have alcohol on my breath. I've had someone show up at my door before saying, oh, my husband just left me. It was a neighbor that lived down the street. But my husband just left me, and I'm so upset, and I don't know what to do. And, you know, I had to be praying on my doorstep with somebody. Those are the things that happen to you, whether you're in ministry or not. Someone knows you're a Christian, they're going to come to you. And if you got somebody who's struggling with these things, and they open the door, and you open the door, and you got a bud in your hand, and they're like, well, I was going to come ask you for prayer about my drinking, but maybe we should just throw one back together. Right? I didn't want to run into that. Okay? But the two main reasons, Matthew 26:29, Jesus says, I will not drink of this fruit of the vine from now until the day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom. If it's good enough for Jesus not to drink, it's good enough for me. Second reason was that I never wanted my kids to say that they saw it in my house. I never wanted, or that they learned from me or had access to it because I was exercising my liberty in Christ. Right? We do have liberty. We do have freedom in Christ. And I'm not saying to you, you can't drink. That's not what the message is here. But please be careful. The Bible has so many strong warnings. So that's between you and the Holy Spirit. I'm not trying to put that trip on you, but if you feel God putting that on you, go to Him and find out what He has to say about it. Okay? and you do what he tells you to do. For me, this was what he told me to do, so that's what I've chosen to do. Okay? And so we can move on now. So now this is the beginning of signs. Verse 11, it says, this beginning of signs Jesus did in Cana of Galilee and manifested his glory, and his disciples believed in him. And after this, he went down to Capernaum, he, his mother, his brothers, and his disciples, and they did not stay there many days. Capernaum ultimately ends up being sort of the headquarters for Jesus' ministry. This sign with the turning the water to wine was the first recorded miracle. Notice that Jesus is with his mom and his brothers. He also had sisters that we're told of in the other Gospels. But notice there's no mention of Joseph. Where's Joseph? What happened to him? Well, likely at this point it's believed that he's passed away. The last mention of Joseph in the Bible is when they went to Jerusalem when Jesus was 12 years old and he was in the temple with the religious leaders. And then when they headed back to go back to Nazareth, they lost Jesus. You remember that? That's the last mention of Joseph in the scriptures. And so where is he? I don't know. Just an interesting fact, you know, if you want to make a note. And now we come to the cleansing of the temple. And it says in verse 13, now the Passover of the Jews was at hand, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem, and he found in the temple those who sold oxen and sheep and doves and the money changers doing business. And when he had made a whip of cords, he drove them all out of the temple with the sheep and the oxen and poured out the changers' money and overturned the tables. And he said to those who sold doves, take these things away. Do not make my father's house a house of merchandise. Then his disciples remembered that it was written, zeal for your house has eaten me up. So they go on this journey from Capernaum down to Jerusalem, or up to Jerusalem. It's about a 90-mile journey, and they're going there because of the Passover. The Passover was one of three feasts that the men were required to go to every year in Jerusalem. So Jesus, being a good Jew, he's probably done around 30 of these at this point in his life. And this is the first recorded Passover of Jesus' ministry. There's in total recorded that he goes to Jerusalem for Passover three times during his ministry. That's how we get the idea that his ministry was roughly 3 to 3.5 years. Okay? And so he goes there, and they go up to the temple. And this would be the second temple from Ezra and Nehemiah's day. It had been and was being refurbished by Herod the Great. All of this was... Herod the Great was a great architect, and he was a little guy. They say he was about like 4'11 or so, but he wanted to make big things to be remembered by. And so he was in this process of redoing all of the Temple Mount area because he wanted to become, you know, have something that the Jews would be okay and like him for, and because he wanted to leave lasting monuments. And so all this that was going on, the selling of the oxen, the sheep, the doves, was happening in what's called the Court of the Gentiles. It was an area about 3 football fields long and 2.5 football fields wide. And we got to ask ourselves, what's the problem? Why does Jesus come in here? Why does he make a whip of cords? Why does he drive them out? Well, the problem was extortion, really. When you would come up to Jerusalem for Passover, you had to bring a lamb or a dove with you to sacrifice for you and the sins of your sins and the sins of your family for that past year. Well, when they would do this, nobody wants to make, number one, a 90-mile journey from bringing a lamb with them. So some people would come with the idea of, oh, I'll just get one when I get there. Well, what do you think? Supply and demand. The price went, and they start ripping people off. The other thing was, let's say you were a family and you had your little lamb and you brought the little lamb with you to be sacrificed. Remember, the lamb had to be without spot or blemish. What would happen is that the priests would get through, and we went to a bees game last night. It was a good visual for this, Salt Lake Bees, right? My wife has a purse and they have this little stick and they look through to make sure there's no guns or bombs or anything in there, right? So picture that with the religious leaders. You bring your lamb and they're like looking for any imperfection. Oh, there's an imperfection on your lamb. We can't use this one, but we've got some over here for sale. And then they would raise the prices and they would rip the people off. The other thing was they had to pay a temple tax at this time, but they couldn't pay the temple tax with a Roman coin because it had an inscription of Caesar or some other Roman official on it. And they didn't want, they thought it was unclean because it had a Roman official on it. So they had to exchange their currency, much like you do if you're traveling to a foreign nation. You had to exchange your currency from Rome for their currency. But guess what they had? The scales were off. Again, they were ripping the people off. Inflation was high. Supply and demand, the numbers went up, and people were getting ripped off as they were coming to worship the Lord. So if you're getting ripped off every time you come to worship the Lord, are you going to want to go and worship the Lord? I wouldn't. I'd be like, man, I got to do this because it's this religious thing, but I really don't want to because all they're going to do is rip me off when I go down there. That's why when we take the tithe, we say it's between you and the Lord. Do it with a joyful heart. Put it in the box if you want. We're not passing the chicken bucket around. We're not trying to collect money from you every time you walk in. There's no posters that say Triple Tithe Sunday. You know, I know that somebody in this room, you know, wants to give $1,000 today. And then we're just going to stay here until somebody finally writes the check. Right? We're not doing that. Why? Because it makes you not want to come and worship the Lord freely. And that's what was happening here. Not to mention, they were doing this in the court of the Gentiles, so none of the Gentiles could come and worship. Do you want to worship the Lord? And can you worship the Lord if there's all this animals and noises and everything going on in there? It wrecks the mood, so to speak. And so Jesus sees all this going on, and he makes a whip of cords. It doesn't necessarily tell us, but it says he drove them out. If Jesus made a whip, what do you think he did with the whip? Yeah. So oftentimes we see Jesus pictured in our children's ministry stories, or we see Jesus pictured on TV as like meek and mild Jesus. Loves everybody. The birds are on his shoulder. The little children are coming. He's got a halo on his head. Jesus was angry. You know, it's okay to be angry. The Bible says be angry and do not sin. But was Jesus' anger was other-centered anger? And I'm sure, I would love to see this scene, right? Jesus braids this whip out of the cords, which probably took some time, right? He's braiding this whip. And now he turns around, he's like, whap! Get out! Flipping tables. Get these out of here. Whap! I mean, it's hard for us to imagine that, Jesus. But this is what he does. Again, his anger is other-centered because he's keeping people from they're keeping people from worshiping God. And, you know, any of you get angry this week? We don't need a raise of hands. I know you did. But let me ask you a question. Was your anger self-centered or was it other-centered? Let me give you an example. If I get upset in traffic because I'm late or somebody cuts me off or whatever, that's self-centered anger. But if I'm getting upset and angry because the state of California wants to pass a law to allow you to abort babies after they're born, they're going to be, what is it, Joel? 28 days? After they're born, you're talking an almost month-old baby that they wanted to say, well, you know what, I don't really want to deal with this, let's just kill it. And they want to make that legal. That's something we should be angry about. Yeah, that too. But that's other-centered anger. Those are the things that we should stand up and fight for. Those are the things as Christians that we need to get involved in politics and say, that's wrong. Those are the things that we need to stand up and say, God's word says no. But when it's self-centered anger, it's always wrong. Because it's always about the old unholy trinity, me, myself, and I. And so, Jesus does this at the beginning of his ministry. And then they didn't pay attention because 3 years later, at the end of his ministry, all of the other gospels record it. At the end of his ministry, he has to come and do the same thing. And so the Jews answered and they said to him, "What sign do you show us since you do these things?" And Jesus answered and said, "Destroy this temple and in 3 days I will raise it up." Then the Jews said, "It's taken 46 years to build this temple and you will raise it up in 3 days." Hey, worship team, if you guys want to come back up. So the temple construct began in 16 BC and was completed after Herod's death in 63 AD. The whole project took around 80 years to complete. At this point, they're about 46 years in here, and they're like, "What are you talking about?" I know their attitude has to be that of like superiority. "What are you talking about? Destroy this and you're going to be rebuild it in 3 days? Come on. It's 46 years to build this. What are you talking about?" That's sort of the attitude that they would have had. Jesus, over and over, he does it a number of times throughout the Gospels. They ask for a sign, and he tells them the sign that they're going to get, but they missed it every time. They're going to get the sign of the prophet Jonah, who was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the great fish. "So shall the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth." What's he talking about? "Destroy this temple and I'll rebuild it in 3 days." Turn the page. Verse 21, it says, he was speaking of the temple of his body. "Therefore, when he had risen from the dead, his disciples remembered he had said this to them, and they believed the scripture and the word which Jesus had said." Hey, Jesus likened his body to a temple. In 1 Corinthians, the Apostle Paul likens our bodies to the temple of the Holy Spirit. If Jesus was interested in cleaning that physical temple, what needs to go in my personal temple? Is there something that needs to go? We talked about it right before communion, dealing with these things with the Lord. What needs to go? If Jesus were to physically today walk inside your temple, what would need to be turned over, thrown out? What would get the whip in my life? You get the picture? What is it? That's between you and the Lord. If you need prayer for something, come up after. We'll be glad to pray with you. But it's between you and the Lord. But this should cause us to do some searching in our own hearts. What needs to go? Is there something that needs to go? What would Jesus not be okay with? What would he come in and say, "This is interfering in you coming to a better relationship with my Father. Get this thing out of here. Flip it over. Toss it out. Drive it out." I want to give you a verse from Hebrews 4, chapter 12. I'm sorry, Hebrews 4, verse 12. "For the word of God is living and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of the soul and spirit and of joints and marrow, and as a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart." Are you letting God's word stab you, so to speak? Right? It talks about that it cuts right there. Boom! It divides. And it goes in not only to encourage us in our walk with the Lord, but the word of God should go in and should provoke us to like, something is not right. This needs cleansing. This has to be separated out of my life. Psalm 119 verse 9 says, "How can a young man cleanse his ways? By taking heed according to your word. With my whole heart I have sought you. Oh, let me not wander from your commandments. Your word I have hidden in my heart that I might not sin against you." We got to get into the word, guys. If Jesus is going to cleanse our heart, our temple, we've got to get into the word. We've got to spend time with him. And let's finish up the chapter. "Now when he was in Jerusalem at the Passover during the feast, many believed in his name when they saw the signs which he did. But Jesus did not commit himself to them because he knew all men and had no need that anyone should testify of man, for he knew what was in men." Now, many committed themselves to Jesus, but he didn't commit themselves to them. Why? Because they were looking for a false relationship. They wanted the signs, the wonders. They wanted to make him a bread king. They wanted to make him the one that conquers Rome. They didn't want what he had to offer. But those who did want what he had to offer, he committed himself to them. What do we want? Our faith should be based not on signs, not on feelings, not on all the things that we so often seek after, but our faith should be based simply on trust in Jesus and his word and a simple relationship with him. Faith based on the word of God and walking in obedience to it through following Jesus is a lasting, saving faith that will change your life. If you're looking for signs and wonders, they don't always happen. Not like we were talking about earlier. If that's what you're basing your faith on, you're going to continually be looking for something else because you're not seeing that thing anymore. If you just believe God's word, your faith is lasting, it is saving, and you will find that it will change your life. Keep it simple, guys, keep it simple. Let's pray. Father, we thank you today for just this time in your word. And I pray that if there is those things in our own lives that need to go, Lord, that you would just search our hearts, that we would allow you to discern our thoughts and intents, and that you would just cause us to just separate from those things and separate to you. Might we be those who are filled with the Spirit, Lord. Sowing to the flesh only reaps of the things of the flesh, but sowing to the Spirit reaps the Spirit. And so may we do that. May we make that a purposeful thing in our lives. I pray that you just bless your people this week, Lord, that we would put shoes on some of these things, that we would be those who walk in faith, that we would be those who find time in our prayer closet with you, that we would see you work and move miraculously in our own lives, in our marriages, in our families, in our workplaces. And we thank you that you want to do these things for each of us. And this morning, we're not going to spend a lot of time with an altar call or anything. We're going to get to this last song. If you don't have a personal relationship with Jesus, it's this simple. Just say yes. Say yes to Jesus. I want you in my life. And then come down here in the front. Talk to one of us. We'll pray with you. We got Bibles for you. Like if you guys haven't received Jesus, don't leave here today without doing that. Make it something personal this morning between you and him. Let the change happen in your heart. Doesn't matter the prayer you say or the words you say. He knows what your heart has to say to him. And so, Josh, will you come up front for prayer? And then I'll be up here as well for prayer. So once again, Lord, we thank you for this time that we've had together. Would you bless your people in Jesus' name?